Hi everybody, and welcome back to the Flicks the Church Forgot. Tonight I'm going to be reviewing the upcoming Arrow Video Blu-ray release of one of the most whacked out and wild horror movies of the 1980s. Prepare for the shunt, it's Brian Usner's Society. Oh my word, Society. Cult movie producer and writer Brian Usner, who is part of the key creative team behind fantastic Lovecraftian movies like Reanimator and From Beyond, brought his surrealistic vision of class warfare to the screen in 1989. Now, it came out on Medusa Home Video in the UK in September of that year, and it was a few days before my birthday when I was about 15 years old. And anyway, I got to see the film, and I remember even then feeling it was a distinct and unique experience compared to the other horror movies that I'd seen. Arrow Video in the UK are just about to release a shiny new Blu-ray of the film, which I watched last night, and you know what? It's lost none of its power to shock, and I might even argue that I was even more flabbergasted in some ways than the first time round when I saw the end, the finale, the melting, melding flesh in its queasy, high-definition Blu-ray glory, in inverted commas. It's the story of Bill Whitney, played by Baywatch and Days of Our Lives star Billy Warlock. Now, this wasn't Warlock's first experience of horror movies. He actually crops up in Halloween 2 in a small part, but here in Society, not only is he given the lead in a horror movie, but it's in a horror movie that moves down far more conceptual and unsettling alleys than Halloween 2 ever does, though that's a fun film in itself. In the film, his character Bill is a young high school jock type of guy from a wealthy Beverly Hills family, and he's almost 18. He's just about to be nominated as class president, and he's got a new Jeep, the cheerleader girlfriend. On the surface, really everything looks perfect. He's got everything the American teenager would aspire to, but what he also has is teenage angst, or rather, he's got teenage fear and paranoia. You see, he starts to reveal to his therapist, remember this was the 1980s, so therapists were ubiquitous back then, he reveals to his therapist that he's scared of his parents, he's scared of his sister, he's scared of his therapist, and he tells him as much. And it's one of the first things that I really like about Society is that in a teenage movie genre type flick, the angle is often usually my parents don't understand me, or they disapprove of me, or they're boring, or they're overly strict. And there's certainly elements of that here. But straight away we see that Bill isn't frustrated with his family, he's fearful of them. He feels that something might actually be wrong with them. And as the story starts to progress, we start to get very clear cues that, yeah, there appears to be something very wrong, very off message about this particular all-American family. But not just them, other people in the community appear strange and secretive, and not only that, Bill starts seeing strange things that just aren't right, strange half-glimpses of bodies contorting in ways that they ought not to. Or the infamous shower scene where he walks in on his sister and sees something through the frosted glass that looks something from a Bosch or a Dali painting. And so we have a film that's largely about paranoia. Usner himself describes Society in that way, the fear that, you know, those around us might have ulterior motives and may be very different when the blinds are drawn, when the masks come off. And in this way, the film really reminds me, at least the first hour in particular, of another excellent paranoid cinema classic, The Stepford Wives from 1975, where a young photographer and wife start suspecting that the perfect women in her new community are not all that they seem. So both Society and The Stepford Wives center on the idea that the rich and the well-to-do may be actually far more twisted and conspiratorial than we may think. However, Society goes many steps further than The Stepford Wives by flinging this idea headlong into surrealism, grotesqueness, and utterly demented cinematic moments, where we discover that the community, led mainly by a guy called Judge Carter, this cigar-smoking man with the power to make staffing decisions in Washington, is kind of obsessed with something called the shunt. Now, the film keeps back for an hour what the shunt is. We don't really know if it's a ritual or it's a sport, perhaps it's both. But Carter and others throw out lines like, I love the smell of the hunt and the taste of the shunt. Like, huh? What's he on about? And when the film finally shows you exactly what the shunt is, you need to prepare for a pretty horrifying and bizarre 20 or some minutes of your life. As I said, the film came out in the late 1980s, and in the early 80s to mid 80s, rubberized special effects with stretching latex and air bladders and dripping goo were extremely popular in horror. Films like Street Trash and The Stuff and many others took latex effects to memorable extremes. And now, I don't want to give away what happens in the finale of this, but let's just say Yuzna was working off an original script, and he decided one of the things he would love to see and push into the script is this idea of flesh joining flesh. And from that idea, he geared the original script for Society. The extras mentioned that originally it was only about like a human blood cult, into something that's far more surreal and irrational. Indeed, the film in many ways is quite irrational. It's difficult to make sense of it at times, but Yuzna makes a good point in these extras on the Arrow disc that when it comes to cinematic choices, he will always choose ideas over rationalism, and you sort of got to admire him for sticking so clearly to that principle here. Dario Argento's another guy who sometimes just says, who cares about rationalism? Let's just do that because it's great. Now, the film is best remembered for its shocking finale, and so it's not a surprise to find that some viewers might actually get frustrated with the build-up to this. The first hour or so is basically a lot of Bill suspecting things aren't quite right, and yet often having his suspicions proved baseless somehow, as if it's all in his mind. This fairly repetitive story device might actually make some viewers a little restless. But for me, I think there is enough weirdness and interesting subtext and some period stuff going on since it's so long ago that makes the first hour still pretty cool. But it's the finale that tips this over into something completely different. Now, what's the film about? What is it saying? Well, as Yuzna says, it's certainly a film about paranoia, but I would say it's specifically, I think, paranoia about class at one level. There's lots of snippets of dialogue where the ideas of being part of a privileged society is a birthright and cannot be crossed or accessed by the lower classes. And certainly, I mean, we're in the UK here, and we've just had a general election where the rhetoric of some of the opposing politicians has been that the rich are getting richer and they're feeding off the working class who are taking the brunt of all of these sort of austere budgets. And while I very much doubt any of the politicians would recommend Yuzna's Society as a good way of learning that point, for those who do see the film, they're going to see this class system complaint in a full and very obvious parody. Is the film about the secret societies of the rich and powerful, like maybe the Illuminati, who are somehow who are somehow less than or indeed more than human? Well, yeah, you could read some David Icke type ideas into this, I guess. But there's also the theme of twisted sexuality, which I think in some ways is the most disturbing aspect of the film. Throughout the film, we get this impression that there is this sensuous edge or curve to these hidden secrets of the community, which slip off the bounds of traditional expression and fall far deeper into Freudian territory. And I think it's that which makes the lead-up, but in particularly the finale, such uncomfortable viewing. The film title's credit sequence makes this very clear that something weird's going on. What we see at the very start is what looks like gloopy, writhing tentacles folding and slopping against each other in slow motion while the Eton boating song is played. Now, if you don't know Eton, there's a prestigious college in the UK known for its wealthy, powerful pupils. Indeed, our current Prime Minister and other members of the Cabinet went there, and they're often criticised as being part of this snooty, old, privileged Etonian club. I've driven through Eton College once or twice, it's not that far from us, and it's a place steeped in tradition, and yes, privilege. Yeah, pretty soon, as the music plays, you start to realize that these aren't tentacles, these are people sliding and writhing against one another as this Eton music plays. And straight away you know that this film is not just about class discussion, but it's headed into more R-rated directions. It's about something even more widespread. And in particular, the finale feels, especially the way the character Blanchard reacts to it, is shocking. I won't say any more than that, but I felt it still saw shocks today and feels both wild and surreal, yet immediate and disturbing. Indeed, Tim Bartel plays Blanchard, and it's him, I think, that pushes those moments of beyond gloopy street trash type fun into something that's sometimes quite unsettling. In the extras, Usner says that he had to cut down some of those scenes, not because the effects were too much, but because Bartel's acting was so harrowing. Yet what I especially like about the film, and I think that in some ways it's the message that I'm taking from it, is the idea of when a person feels different, when they don't fit in. That's what Bill feels like in the film at the very start. He feels different. He actually wonders if he's been adopted. He's convinced that he must have been because he has such a disconnect from his parents. And this feeling of feeling out of place or on a different sort of planet from those around you is a common feeling and is something that we all feel from time to time, particularly when we're growing up. Now, quite by coincidence, on the afternoon before I watched Society, I watched it last night, so yesterday afternoon, I was listening to a podcast called The Liturgists, or The Liturgists, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it, and it's a podcast that explores Christian faith in new various sort of interpretations of various traditions, and on this program yesterday, they had various gay and transgender people on the show, and they were telling this heartbreaking stories of how they grew up in families clearly against homosexuality, usually for Christian reasons, fundamentalist reasons. And that one woman who was transgender who said her mum said to her she would rather her daughter die than be revealed as a transgender person. And these extreme isolation stories were in my head as I watched Society a few hours later, and I felt like they were being writ large on the screen. I'm not saying that Society is about the gay struggle, but, you know, I guess if you were gay, maybe you would read that into it. But the principle seems similar. It's a young boy growing up where those in power are dismissive of who he is, and at once when he's revealed, he seems nothing to them. He can be isolated and removed. He's almost like a non-entity because he is not falling in line with the lifestyle of his family and community. And as I said in the film, Bill is really afraid of his family and those around him, and it just struck me that this was a similar emotion that was being communicated by some of those gay or transgender people that I was listening to, growing up in a society that had very strict rules as to how to be, and if they did not fit that, if they didn't meld themselves into the accepted norm, that society would basically consume, assimilate, ultimately destroy them and, indeed, their individuality. Now, of course, it's not just sexual orientation that can make us feel isolated and lonely. Many of us feel a bit different just for all sorts of different reasons. Heck, just being a horror fan, you know what it's like. Just being a horror fan can sometimes make other people feel you're a bit of an odd person. And believe me, if someone walks in on you while you are watching the last few acts of Society, they're going to think you're a complete freak, and you might just get a little taste of isolation yourself. There's an extra on the disc called The Masters of the Shunt, and it features an interview with Billy Warlock and Tim Bartel and some of the other actors, and after watching it, it made me realize that while Society is a great film, it's also a sort of testament to the workmanlike nature of actors. The material they had to work with here is so out there, it's so bizarre, that as they are interviewed, they keep saying, yeah, the script was really weird, and yeah, when we filmed it, it was really weird, and yeah, when I watch it back now, it's like really weird. And I mean, one of the actresses in it, she comments on how strange the script was, and indeed she has to deliver the line, how would you like your tea? Cream? Sugar? Or do you want me to pee in it? You're like, what? And thinking about it, just imagine some of these actors, you know, having to share this film with their parents and their friends and, you know, hey, come see the movie I did. It's good, really. And in particular, all the extras and the supporting actors in the finale, and most certainly David Wiley, who plays Judge Carter, who I think ended up cropping up in Grand Theft Auto game, Vice City, I think, as a voice of one of the people on the street. And yet in this, he's straight there, he's not holding back, and you get the impression that you've got a bunch of people who just did as they were told, following the script, and they were really professional in the midst of what was a wild and experimental exploitation project, an art project. And I think it's hats off to the acting profession in a way, for actors who simply just have to slot into a director or writer's crazy vision, and they have to act out these visions for the camera, and they do their job and they do it well, and you're convinced by them, and yet they themselves, even afterwards, are not really sure what it's all about. You know, Society is not a perfect film. It's got flaws and it's kind of clunky in parts, and even Usner accepts that himself. And in a way, it's like body horror. It's described by some places as minor body horror. It's not minor. It's a body horror movie, I guess, for want of a better term. And so it's in Cronenberg territory, you could say. And if Cronenberg had made a version of this, I guess he would have probably made it slicker or at least less TV movie-like in places. And yes, some of the effects towards the end of the film were a little bit overly comical. The score, in some ways, I'm quite happy with the score in a way, but it's slightly flimsy. And you think, oh, apart from the Ethan boating legs bit that's inspired, you think, oh, it'd have been cool if they could have gotten Richard Band in to do some of those orchestral scores. But I think that was getting harder and harder to do for budgetary reasons back then. Bride of Reanimator was about to be worked on, and the classical score from Reanimator had to be stripped down back to synths for that. So, okay, they might not have been able to do it. But I wonder if Society could have worked even better with some sort of experimental avant-garde type music. And yeah, the first hour might be a tiny bit plodding, and even when it comes to the sound effects for the fighting, for example, the punches sound like they sound a bit cartoony. But despite the flaws, this is Yuzna's vision, and it might be a bizarre and frankly disgusting one, but it's difficult to forget, and it definitely prompts reflection. Some critics called the film appalling when it first came out, or pretentious, but if you can handle extreme cinema, then you might find this as an 80s film that pretty much flopped in the US, but yet it has a pile more invention and ideas than many, many horror movies, five times the budget, five times the success. And to think that Yuzna made this borderline obscene goo fest in the same year that he wrote Honey, I Shrunk the Kids for Disney. I think it was for Disney. Well, that is as surreal as anything you'll see in this movie. Now, Arrow Video are releasing Society on the 8th of June in UK in 2015, this is, and it's a newly remastered 2K digital transfer that's been approved by Yuzna himself, and it looks great. It's certainly the best I've ever seen it. To the extent, actually, that some of the Screaming Mad George makeup effects are less convincing. You can see the join and discoloration between skin and latex. However, I'm more than happy to spot those things in exchange for a crisp, pleasing transfer like this. And many of the effects actually hold up quite well. There's some great extras on here too. It's almost of all of the talking head interview variety. Though there is a music video by Screaming Mad George, the effects artist, called Persecution Mania, which is pretty wild. It's got like a TV sprouting spider legs with the screen becoming a bulging cyclopean eye. It's pretty cool. Anyway, it's a limited edition of 3,000 copies, and it comes in a dual format. It's a DVD and a Blu-ray with a collector's booklet and even a comic book sequel in a perfect bound book that I can't show you as the screener Arrow sent me is just the Blu-ray, but put it this way, if you're up for some satire that might make you gag and cover your mouth with repulsion, you are going to find both in large 80s-style quantities in Brian Yuzna's Society. Well, that's it for another Flicks the Church Forgot. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter or visit the Facebook page at the Flicks the Church Forgot. Or why not visit the mothership at my new website, theflicksthechurchforgot.com. But until next time, if your parents mention that there's going to be a shunt at your house tonight, whatever you do, do not go home. And don't forget, the Flicks the Church Forgot.